and now call on Ciarán Brady from history.
But those who forget their past are condemned to repeat it. I thought some of the lowlights here would have actually said that to me, and failed to see it, you know? You know the idea that if you only had learned what the historians had to tell you, you wouldn't have had this nuclear holocaust in the first place. And if you don't keep us on board the raft, it's going to happen again, yeah? With bullshit, actually. You know why? You know why? Because it rests on two things which we historians can't stand over. The first thing is a fact. Those who can't remember their history. Everybody forgets their history. God damn it, does anybody here remember who Art McMurray Cavanaugh was and Shane O'Neill was? I remember Shane O'Neill was, but that's sad. Does anybody know who James Fenton Lawler is? All that? 40%, a recent survey I heard from the Royal Radio, BBC, 40% of third level students in the United Kingdom think that Winston Churchill is the dog on the television. Condemned to repeat it. What? Repeat what? If we could know that history repeats itself, then we wouldn't be doing history. No, we'd be doing crap like sociology. International relations. All of those things that claim to know that there are laws which you can predict things about, where you can say it's going to happen again and again and again. That assumes that we're outside of history. But the bad news is, they're not. None of us is. We're not. None of you are. We're locked into the damn thing, and you can't get out of it. Before the nuclear holocaust and after the nuclear holocaust, it's still gonna get you. Now that isn't to say, just because we don't know what's happening, and we don't, and any historian tells you they know what's happening. David Starkey, I imagine, David Starkey telling us what to do next. Imagine if we were enrolled by historians, God knows. But just because we don't know what's going to happen next, just because we don't know what the laws are, just because we don't have some sense. There are two kinds of ways in which we can make some sense of this. But there's a kind of element, isn't there, of necessity in that thing. A kind of predictability of a limited kind. You look like a rich guy to me. Why are you rich? Why are you richer than I am? But you know, that's what being born like that, is it fair? He looks like an outsider, and I'm sorry. But it's not your fault, it's not my fault, it's just the way it happened. And look at that person there, that the genes are about to sprout that cancer spores that will kill you when you're 47. And nobody knows where it's coming from, but it is there. That is the element. Of predestination of some kind. The thing is, we don't know how it works. We don't know when it's going to come into action because the concatenation, the contingency of the whole thing is unpredictable. It is determined by chance. And nobody knows when chance is going to offer itself to us. And anybody who thinks that they can't count with chance don't understand what chance can do to us. So, given the fact that that's life for us, what are you going to do about it? I've got a couple of suggestions. Drink. Drink. Do drugs. It is a really good way to do it in the short term. Amnesia is the best way to get around this problem, except it has some drawbacks. You get sick, you feel awful, and you die horribly. The next thing, though, you can do is what you do philosophy, do literature, do English, do the sort of thing that my colleagues all enjoy doing, and they're absolutely right. And I agree with them. I enjoy reflection, speculation, the joy of imagination, imagining the world the way it is, the way it ought to be. That's what we have to learn when we're stuck in a world without prediction, without certainty, where chance prevails, stuck in this world given to us by original sin, eating that tree of knowledge that's made us separated from all knowledge of the eternal world. And I would like for us to sit back and reflect and think about our awful condition, except for the problem that we have to eat. We do have to eat. Well, you don't have to eat. You can bring us to death. You can cut you through that. But if you want to continue on in this vale of tears, it is a good idea to eat. It isn't just me saying this. The person who did this to us in the first place threw us out of the Garden of Eden, made us think like this, separated us from the whole ideal of being one with the world that created God. And God is a vindictive bastard who did it for me. By the sweat of thy brow shalt thou earn thy bread, till thou return unto the ground out of which wast thou taken. For dust thou art, and unto dust thou shalt return. God is the first materialist. There's a man. But he said worse things than that. I mean, what a bad thing. Unto the woman, he says. This is Genesis 3, 13 to 16, for those who wish to know. I will greatly multiply thy sorrow, and thy kiss, Victor.
That's really interesting. I was just wondering, do you have any reasons why you should stay on this, like, life?
because if I don't stay on the life raft, there'll be no life raft left for anybody when it comes to the end of it. It's for me. For you. Anyway, you interrupted me when I wanted to talk about half the human race and chauvinist pig. I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. That means breeding, yes. Meaning generating more people, more history. Thy conception, in sorrow and in pain shall thou bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. Look at God. He does materialism, then he does history, all that progenation, all that stuff going on, and then he does class conflict. He shall rule over thee. Do you want to go for this? God is the original historical materialist. God, not Marx, has made us be with this. God has presented us with a Marxian nightmare. Now I realize the room to which I'm speaking. I realize that this is a group that is inviting the fascists from the British National Party. I'm not worried about being left on the life raft. I'm worried about getting out of here. After mentioning Karl Marx, but let me just say this. It's not that I necessarily agree with Marx. Please don't hurt me. You could look at it in a negative way. Marx, after all, was positive, thought there was way out of things by way of revolution and so on. But you don't have to say that. What you can say is that it just goes on. That it just goes on, and what happens after God created these conditions of historical materialism is a life in which the crimes, follies and misfortunes of mankind, to quote Edward Gibbon, historian, are the common pattern of history, our lot. And what are we going to do about it? Is there any escape from this? Well, there is, but it doesn't lie, actually, in the, and it doesn't lie in the history department, or in TCD, that none of my colleagues are here to say that, because they might think that's where the solution lies. It lies actually in all of us. It lies in our capacity to recognize this as the fundamental, irreducible, inescapable, and unavoidable elements of our condition. And to bloody well do something about it. And how do you do something about it? You do something about it by asking the right questions. What is the problem here? Where did that problem come from? What's my solution for that problem? And why do I prefer that solution over another solution? Am I afraid of this one? Do I desire that one? Why is it I'm going that way? You think not only critically about the conditions, you think critically about your analysis of the conditions. And that's what history teaches us. I started with a cliché, and I'm going to end with a cliché. If only one that is coined, newly minted from one of the august alumni of Trinity College, Dublin, and even more importantly, because I'm afraid you're going to rip my heart out, one of the most distinguished members of the college's philosophical society. The price of freedom, said John Philpot Curran. The price of freedom is eternal vigilance. I don't really know what he meant by eternal there, and I'm not at all sure that I share his notion of an indefinite freedom, but I like the jib of his cut. What he says here is that we must be constantly vigilant, constantly on the watch, constantly asking the critical questions about us, about where we got from, why we're here, what we're going to do next, that are essentially historical questions. And I accept not all historians ask those questions. And all historians don't have to be on the boat. And indeed, historians don't have to be on the boat at all, as long as we think the way historians should think. If we think the way historians should think, if we feel the way historians should think, and above all, if we act the way historians should think, then it's not that we'll be free, but we'll be a lot more happy, we'll be a lot less unfree, and we might possibly